villages, the wells. So at that time they will use pulley in order to lift the water using buckets. So that we call as a pulley. So what is pulley? What are the components of pulley? How we will construct pulley? A pulley is a, it is made. So this is the picture of a pulley. It is a metallic or wooden disc with a grooved rim. It is a metallic or wooden disc with a grooved rim. This we call as a grooved rim. Okay. It is a metallic or wooden disc with a grooved rim. A string or rope is used around the groove at the rim. The disc rotates about an axle passing through its center. The disc rotates. This disc rotates about an axle passing through its center. So, if they ask a question like the construction of the pulley, so what do you write? It is a metallic. It is a metallic or wooden disc. Okay. It is a metallic or wooden disc.
A single fixed pulley in which the axle
slings fixed to a rigid support through the frame. So what you can see, it is a single fixed pulley, and here axle will be assigned now and is connected to a rigid support through frame. And one hand you have the load and the other hand you have the frame. You should apply effort. Okay. A single fixed pulley in which the axle fixed to a rigid support and inextensible strong spring of negligible mass passes around the broad rim of the pulley. And inextensible spring of negligible mass passes around the broad rim of the pulley. Okay, so here the axle will be fixed in a at a center through a rigid support to the frame, and inextensible strain of negligible mass passes through the groove at the groove rim from of the pulley. One end of the string is connected to the load, while the effort E is applied at the other free end. So the load and effort act downward directions. Both load and effort acts downward direction. So what we can observe here, a single fixed pulley in which the axle is fixed at the center through a rigid support and an inextensible strong string of negligible mass passes through the groove rim of the pulley. One end of the pulley is connected to the load and the other free end is the effort to be applied, and both load and effort act downward direction. On pulling the string downwards, if you want to lift the load, for example, if you want to lift a water glove bucket from the well, so what you should do, you should apply effort, whether in upward direction or downward direction, you should apply effort in the downward direction, because the load will be at the down and the well. So in order to lift it up, you should apply the effort downwards. So you should apply effort here in order to move the load upwards. In order to come the load upwards, you should apply the effort in the downward direction. On pulling the string downwards by the effort, the pulley rotates. This pulley will rotate and the load moves up. The tension throughout the string T remains the same. The tension of the string remains the same in both the cases, the load and effort. On pulling the pulley, on applying some effort in the downward direction, the pulley will rotate and the load moves up. There will be some tension in the string throughout the string and it will be the same, acting upwards. This type of pulley is used to lift the loads, very small loads. This type of single fixed pulley is used to lift very small loads. For example, to lift the water bucket and some basket, we use this single fixed pulley. So next, let me calculate the mechanical advantage and velocity ratio of a single fixed pulley. the mass of the train and the friction attacks, then the balance condition we have of load. We have load equals tension, L equals T, and effort equals T. So this is the equation 1 and equation 2. From 1 and 2 we have load equals effort. From 1 and 2 we have load equals effort. In an ideal case of a machine, in an ideal case, the effort needed to lift the load is equal to the load itself. In an ideal case, for example, this load will be of 10 kg or 98 Newton. So the load weighs of 10 kg or 98 Newton. So what is the effort needed? The effort needed also 10 kg or 98 Newton only. This is possible only in ideal case. This is possible only in ideal case. In an ideal case, the effort needed to lift the load is equal to the load itself. In only in ideal case, the effort needed to lift the load is equal to the load itself. So what we can conclude from here? Mechanical advantage equals load by effort. So what is load? That is T. What is effort? T. Cancel it, get 1. So mechanical advantage equals 1. So there is no gain in mechanical advantage. There is no gain in mechanical advantage. If we neglect the mass of the spring and the friction at the axle, then in balance position we have load equal is equal to the tension T. So we have load equals tension and effort equals tension. Then from equation 1 and 2, the load and effort are equal. Only in ideal case we have the effort needed to lift the load is equal to the load itself. So they can conclude that mechanical advantage is equal to 1. So there is no gain in the mechanical advantage. Now let us calculate the velocity ratio. replace with dE by dl. So what? X divided by x. So it can cancel. So the velocity ratio equals 1. The point of application of effort moves the distance x downwards. The load will be moves up. The load will moves up. So it will moves up at the same distance in upwards. That is x only. So the velocity ratio is v divided by vl. The velocity of effort to the velocity of load. That is nothing but displacement of effort. Displacement by of load. So x more than x only. X divided by x. 1. Velocity ratio is 1. So next, what we should calculate? Next is the efficiency. So efficiency equals mechanical advantage divided by velocity ratio. Efficiency equals mechanical advantage divided by velocity ratio. Both are 1. So that is efficiency equals 1 or 100%. Efficiency equals 1 or 100%. In an actual practice, there is always some friction at the axle or at the pulley bearings. There is always some friction. We won't get 100% efficiency. In actual practice, there will be some loss of energy due to friction. So the effort needed is little more than the load to be lifted. In order to lift the load, we need more effort than the load. So for example, if I want to lift the load of 10 kg here, so we need more than that. For example, we need the effort 11 kg here or 15 kg here. So the effort needed to be more. The effort needed to be more than the load to be lifted. The effort needed to be more than the load to be lifted. This mechanical advantage is always less than 1, but velocity ratio is 1. So, the efficiency will always be less than 1 or 100%. In an actual practice, there is always some friction at the axle or pulley bearings. So, then we won't get 100% efficiency. Okay, in order to lift the load, the effort needed to be more than the load. And the mechanical advantage should be less than 1. And the efficiency also always less than 100% only. So where we use the single fixed pulley? A single fixed pulley is used only to change the direction. A single fixed pulley is used only to change the direction of effort to be applied. If that's the question, where we use the single fixed pulley? A single fixed pulley is used to change the direction of effort to be applied. diagram of a single movable pulley. So this is the axle and this is the frame. A pulley. So what is a single movable pulley? A pulley whose axis of rotation is movable. A pulley whose axis of rotation is movable is called is movable pulley. A pulley whose axis of rotation is movable, such that not fixed in a position. It is not fixed in a position. Its axis of rotation is movable. It's called a movable pulley. Figure shows the this picture shows a single movable pulley. So what we have observed here, a single movable pulley is suspended by passing a single movable pulley is suspended by passing a inextensible string of negligible mass around its groove ring. So what you can observe here, this pulley is suspended, this single movable pulley is suspended through an inextensible string of negligible mass. It's suspended, this pulley is suspended through an inextensible string of negligible mass through a rigid support connected to the rigid support by means of a hook edge. And there also we have axle. That axle is connected to the frame. The load L has to be raised. Is suspended from the axle. The load L has to be raised, and this load is suspended to the axle. One end of the string is tied to the hook. One end of the string is tied to the hook, and the other end will be free. And that is called the effort end. That is the tension T acts on the both sides. That is T on both sides of the pulley. This picture shows a single movable pulley where you can observe that this pulley is suspended by an inextensible string of negligible mass around its groove rim. So next, what we have? The load. The load is connected. The load L has to be raised through an axle. The load L has to be. So the load L is suspended. Sorry, the load L is suspended from the axle. One end of the string is tied to the hook, and the other end of the string, that is the effort, is at the free end. Then we should apply some effort in order to lift the load. The tension T acts on the string on both the sides of the pulley. So next, the mechanical advantage and velocity ratio. So what is the mechanical advantage? Here also, if we neglect the friction in the bearing, in the pulley bearing or an axle, and if we neglect the weight of the pulley and the string, if we neglect the weight of the pulley and string, and if we neglect the friction in the pulley or an axle, the load L is balanced. The load L is balanced by the tension T of two segments of the string, and the effort E balances the tension at only one end. So if we neglect the friction of the axle, friction in the pulley and the axle, and if we neglect the weight of the pulley and the string, we can have a buffer in the free end of the string. It's pulled. See, I have written in a dotted lines. When the free end of the pulley is lifted upwards, what happens? The load moves upwards. Okay, this load becomes in this position. When the free end of the string is pulled up by the effort through a is equal to displacement of F1 to the displacement of F2. So what is the displacement of F1? That is what we can write here. dE. That is yes. And what is the load? Load is raised only half of it. So that is yes by 2. If you raise the effort, so if you lift the free end of the string, if you lift the free end of the string in an upward direction through a distance, yes, then the load will be moved raised up through a distance, yes, fine. If you raise the free end of the string, that is through effort, that is yes, through a distance, yes, and the load will be raised up through a distance, yes, by 2. So what we can write? The velocity ratio will also be 2. So next, coming to the efficiency. So what is the efficiency? Efficiency equals mechanical advantage divided by velocity ratio. Mechanical advantage is also 2, and velocity ratio is also 2. 2 and 2 get cancelled. So finally, what we are left over with? Only 1 or 100%. Efficiency is 1 or 100% for an axial steerable movable pulley. Due to the friction in the pulley bearings or an axle, the weight of the pulley and the string, the effort needed to lift the load, L will be more than L by 2. And so the mechanical advantage is less than 2. Due to the friction of the pulley bearings or the axle and the weight of the string and the pulley, in order to, the effort needed to lift the load will be more than L by 2. So the mechanical advantage will be less than 2. And one more thing is that, since velocity ratio remains 2, hence efficiency will be less than 1. So efficiency will also remain less than 1. It is an ideal case. In order to lift the load, the effort needed should be more than L by 2, and the efficiency should always be less than 2, and the mechanical advantage should be less than 2. How we can change the direction of effort using a movable pulley? And the difference between the single movable pulley and the single fixed pulley, that we are learning in the next class. Thank you.